إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلله فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين أما بعد. My dear brothers and sisters, it is from the plan of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that after He commanded us to believe in Him and follow His religion, that it was not enough for us to simply believe and that's it. And this is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made it part of His plan to test His believing servants. And this is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, أَحَسِبَ النَّاسُ أَن يُتْرَكُوا أَن يَقُولُوا آمَنَّا وَهُمْ لَا يُفْتَنُونَ. Do the people think that they will be left to simply say, we have believed? أَن يَقُولُوا آمَنَّا وَهُمْ لَا يُفْتَنُونَ, and they will not be tested. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَلَقَدْ فَتَنَّ الَّذِينَ مِنْ قَبْلِهِمْ فَلَيَعْلَمَنَّ اللَّهُ الَّذِينَ صَدَقُوا وَلَيَعْلَمَنَّ الْكَاذِبِينَ. And then Allah says, verily we tested those who came before you, the nations of the past, so that we can distinguish the truthful from those who are not truthful. Meaning, the truthful in terms of their belief. Are they really truthful in terms of what they have believed in? And so this is an ongoing struggle that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He wants us not only to believe, not only to do righteous actions, but to strive hard and to remain firm and steadfast. And so remaining firm and steadfast upon the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not an easy thing. And this is the test. This is the test of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in order to distinguish the strong from the weak and the truthful from the liars. And so Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in various places in the Quran has commanded us to remain firm and steadfast. For example, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, commanding the believers when they face the enemy on the battlefield, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا إِذَا لَقِيتُمْ فِئَةً فَثْبُتُوا. يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا, Ibn Abbas, he says that when you hear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala addressing the believers, O you who believe, when you hear this, pay attention. Because either you are about to be commanded with something or forbidden from something. So pay attention. يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا إِذَا لَقِيتُمْ فِئَةً. O you who believe, if you face an enemy, if you meet an enemy, meaning on the battlefield, فَتْبُتُوا, stand firm, stand steadfast. Don't turn your backs, don't start shaking. And this is why one of the major sins, in fact, among the 10 major sins that the Prophet ﷺ mentioned are the sins that cause a person's destruction. One of those sins is to flee from the battlefield after the battle has begun. And so here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commands us to remain firm and steadfast. This can also apply in our daily lives, for the enemies are throwing all types of fitan at us. There are two types of fitan. there are the fitan of ash-shubuhat and of ash-shahawat. Ash-shubuhat are the fitan that deal with a person's belief, doubts that he starts having, such as the existence of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is a doubt that the enemies of Islam throw at us. And all the other doubts related to our belief. These are called shubuhat. And so we must remain firm and steadfast upon our iman and not fall for these shubuhat. The second type of fitan are the shahawat. And the shahawat are the worldly desires. The desires that one has for the dunya, such as women, wealth, etc. And so, the enemies are throwing all types of shahawat at us. And so we must remain firm and steadfast and not fall for these shahawat. Also, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has commanded us to remain firm and steadfast, not temporarily, but rather until the day we die. This is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا اتَّقُوا اللَّهَ حَقَّ تُقَاتِهِ وَلَا تَمُوتُنَّ إِلَّا وَأَنْتُمْ مُسْلِمُونَ. Again, O you who believe, fear Allah, the fear that He is most deserving of, and do not die except as Muslims, except in a state of submission. And so, here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has ordered us to remain firm and steadfast until the day we meet Him subhanahu wa ta'ala. And so it is upon us to remain firm and steadfast in times of fitan, trials. And the times that we live in today are times of fitan, great trials and tribulations, especially for the Muslims living in this part of the world, and especially for the youth and the young ones. But the question is, what should one remain firm and steadfast upon? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He says that He keeps the believers firm and steadfast upon iman. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, يُثَبِّتُ اللَّهُ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا بِالْقَوْلِ الثَّابِتِ فِي الْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا وَفِي الْآخِرَةِ. Here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that He keeps firm and steadfast the believers, those who believe, upon the word that is steadfast. What is this word? It is the kalima of at-tawheed. And so at-tawheed and iman is what we should remain firm and steadfast upon. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us that He keeps the believers firm and steadfast upon this iman and this tawheed in this life and in the akhirah. فِي الدُّنْيَا وَفِي الْآخِرَةِ. And so this iman that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will keep the believers firm upon is the iman of the heart that necessitates actions. And so a person can't simply believe with his heart and say that this is sufficient. Rather, he must follow it up with action. And this is why it is the belief of Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah that iman is what? Iman is belief with the heart, saying it with the tongue, and acting upon it with the rest of your body parts. And so actions are a part and parcel of iman. A person who does not act, he does not do anything that Allah has commanded him to do, he does not pray, he does not fast, etc., he cannot be called a mu'min, he cannot be called a believer. And so, we are living in times of fitan. And these fitan, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam actually informed us about them. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said in the hadith that is narrated by Anas ibn Malik, he said that before the day of judgment, And so this is one of the signs of the Day of Judgment. He said before the Day of Judgment, there will be fitan, trials, tests, tribulations, like parts of a dark night. كَقِطْعٍ مُظْلِمَةٍ, like parts of a dark night. In it, a man will wake up as, in the morning he will wake up as a mu'min, as a believer. And by the evening, he will be a kafir, he will be a disbeliever. And in it, a person will be a kafir. In the morning, he will wake up as a kafir, and by the evening, he will be a mu'min. And then the Prophet ﷺ said, in these times, there will be people who will sell their deen at the price of the dunya. And this is exactly what we see in our times today. People who chase after the dunya at the price of their deen. And so the commentators of this hadith, the scholars, they have said regarding this hadith, that this hadith refers to one of the signs of the Day of Judgment. That there will be great fitan, trials, tribulations, like parts of a dark night. Black due to its uncertainty, lack of clarity. And so there will be a lot of uncertainty in these times of fitan. In it, a man will be constantly changing. He will be constantly changing. His sayings and his actions will become diverse. And so, for him, the good has become bad, and the bad has become good. Iman has become kufr, and kufr has become iman. Sunnah has become bid'ah, and bid'ah has become sunnah. And so this is the meaning of this hadith. And then they go on to say that perhaps it may be that iman has become kufr and kufr has become iman, and so these people will sell their deen at the price of the dunya. And so what the Prophet ﷺ told us over 1400 years ago is exactly what we see in our day and age. How many people do we know who used to be with us here in this masjid? And now they're gone. You don't see them anymore. Some have left Islam, while others have not left Islam, but they become weak in their iman. And so one who used to grow his beard now is clean shaven. The sister who used to wear hijab, you don't see her with a hijab anymore. And so on and so forth. And so these are the fitan, the trials, the tests that we live in today. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, if we look at his early life, or rather the early years of his prophethood, we find that it was a time of great tests and fitan. There were companions who were tortured, who were beaten, who were even killed. And some of these companions used to come to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and seek his assistance. And so Khabbab ibn al-Arat, the companion radiallahu an, who was one of the young companions, the youth from amongst the companions, he one day came to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam as the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was leaning against the Kaaba. And he came and complained to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam about their situation, the situation of the Muslims at that time. And so he said, will you not ask Allah to help us? Will you not invoke upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant us victory? And so the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he sat up and he admonished this young companion. He said, among those before you, meaning among the nations of the past, there would be a believer amongst them who would be taken, and a pit would be buried for him in the ground. And he would be thrown into this pit, And then a saw would be brought and placed over his head, and he would be chopped into two pieces. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he went on to say, yet all of that did not cause him to abandon and leave his religion. In fact, the only thing that caused that to happen was because he kept on to his deen. He remained firm and steadfast. He did not give up. Then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, by Allah, this deen will be completed and will gain triumph and victory until a rider goes from Sana'a to Hadramaut, fearing nobody except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the wolf, lest it may eat up his sheep. And then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, however, you are a people impatient. And so the lesson that we are to learn from this incident is that in times of fitan, in tests and trials, we are supposed to be patient and not give up. We are supposed to remain firm and steadfast and not give in to the temptations of the dunya or the doubts that the kuffar may throw at us. And in another hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam informed us that there will come a time when one who remains patient over his deen is like one who grabs hold of hot boiling coal. Even though it's very hot, he remains firm and steadfast, not letting it go. And this is the rope of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that one should never let go. He should always put his trust and hope in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that eventually, after this darkness, there will be light at the end of the tunnel. And so why is it that we find a lot of people changing? A lot of people, their iman is shaking. Why is it that we find the people changing from iman to kufr, or from high iman to low iman? There are many reasons that we can mention, but inshallah I'll just mention a few of those reasons. One of the reasons why people change and become weak and do not remain firm and steadfast is self-deceit. They think they're something, and so they become self-deceived. And there is a story narrated in Bukhari where there was a Christian in the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam who had embraced Islam. He became Muslim. And he memorized Surah Al-Baqarah and Surah Ali Imran. And not only that, but he was one of those who used to record the revelation. Whatever was revealed to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he would write it down. He was one of the scribes of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. However, later on he returned to Christianity. He apostated and returned to Christianity. And he left the Muslims and returned to his Christian companions. And one of the things that he used to say after he left Islam, one of the things he used to say is that Muhammad knows nothing except what I write down. And so he thought he was something. He felt self-deceit. This is what you call self-deceit. And so he passed away, he died, and his Christian companions went out to bury him. And when they buried him, They buried him in the ground. They left, and the next morning they came and found his body had surfaced and was lying on the ground. So they said, this must have been the work of Muhammad and his companions, because he left their religion and he left them. So they buried him into the ground a second time, and then they left, and then the next morning they came and they found the body had surfaced once again. And this happened for 3 consecutive days. Finally, they realized that this was not the work of any human being, and they had left his body as it was without burying it. And so this Christian could have become a companion. Imagine that. A person abandons not only Islam, but he abandons it at the time of revelation. He could have become a great companion, but he gave up. He gave up all of that for the sake of the dunya and because of his self-deceit. He thought he was something. And so shaitan deceived him and abandoned him. Among the reasons that we see that the people changing and not remaining firm and steadfast is following the hawa, the whims and desires. And this is one of the main reasons why we find people change and they give in to the temptations of the dunya, because of their hawa and their desires. In Surah Al-A'raf, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us of a man from Bani Israel in the time of Musa alayhi salam, who Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had given him religious knowledge, had given him the ayat. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَاتْلُ عَلَيْهِمْ نَبَأَ الَّذِي آتَيْنَا آيَاتِنَا فَانْسَلَخَ مِنْهَا فَأَتْبَعَهُ الشَّيْطَانِ فَكَانَ مِنَ الْغَاوِينَ. Relate to them the story of the one who we had given him our ayat. And so he left them behind. He threw them behind his back. فَأَتْبَعَهُ الشَّيْطَانِ. And so shaitan followed him up and deceived him. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَلَوْ شِئْنَا لَرَفَعْنَاهُ بِهَا وَلَكِنَّهُ أَخْلَدَ إِلَى الْأَرْضِ وَاتَّبَعَ هَوَاهُ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us that had we willed, we could have caused him to rise with our ayat. He could have become a person of status amongst the people. However, أَخْلَدَ إِلَى الْأَرْضِ وَاتَّبَعَ هَوَاهُ. However, he remained clinging onto the ground and he followed his hawa. What did he do? He followed his hawa. He followed his whims and his desires. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala then goes on to give us a parable of this person. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, فَمَثَلُهُ كَمَثَلِ الْكَلْبِ إِن تَحْمِلْ عَلَيْهِ يَلْهَثْ أَوْ تَتْرُكْهُ يَلْهَثْ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us that the parable of this man, the example of this man, is like that of a dog. If you chase it, it will pant. It will let its tongue out and it will pant. And if you leave it alone, it'll pant and let out its tongue also. Meaning that it doesn't make any difference. Whether you try to guide such a person, he will not be guided, because he followed his desires, and then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala closed his heart from accepting the guidance. And so the point here is that following one's desires is one of the main reasons for not remaining firm and steadfast upon Iman. Also, among the reasons that we find people changing and not remaining firm and steadfast is something very common amongst people who become weak in their Iman. And that is underestimating the gravity of sins. Looking down on sins, especially the minor sins. And so the Prophet ﷺ said, "Beware of underestimating sins, for they gather upon a person until they destroy him." Then he gave us an example. He said, it is like a group of people who go out in the desert, they're traveling, and their cook comes, and he wants to cook. So each one goes and brings a branch, a piece of wood, and they gather it until it becomes a large pile. And then they light it, and it becomes a bonfire. So the Prophet ﷺ gave us this example to show us the gravity of sins. That we should not underestimate, especially the minor sins, because they will gather and gather and gather until they become a huge pile like a mountain. And so the scholars have said that as long as a person persists in committing minor sins, it becomes a major sin. And so it is very common for people to look down on the minor sins. A person, he doesn't commit zina. He does not commit zina, but he looks at haram. He looks at what is not permissible for him to look at. And he thinks it to be something small. Yes, it is a minor sin. It is not like zina. But it is, the Prophet ﷺ referred to it as zina. And so it is a type of zina, not the zina that requires punishment, but the zina that will lead to the greater zina. And this is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Quran, He did not command the believing men to refrain from zina. He did not say, لا تزنوا, do not commit zina. Rather, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He commanded the believing men to lower their gazes. Because if they lower their gazes, it will protect them from the greater zina. And so one should never underestimate the gravity of sins, especially the minor sins. For if one does that, it will lead him to destruction, and it will lead him to become weak in his iman, and it will not enable him to remain firm and steadfast upon iman. There are many, many other reasons that we can mention, but the common reason that we can see here is that people who do not remain firm and steadfast, it is as a result of following in the footsteps of shaitan. And so Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has warned us in the Quran in many different places to beware of falling into the footsteps of shaitan. For a person who follows in the footsteps of shaitan, it will cause him to move further and further away from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and it will weaken his iman until it will lead to his destruction. After all this, the question is, what can help us to remain firm and steadfast upon the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? The first means that could help us to remain firm and steadfast upon the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is remembering the greatness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Remembering the greatness of the one who we are sinning. When a person does that, it helps him to refrain from falling into sin. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He mentioned to us His greatness in different parts of the Quran, and also the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has informed us of the greatness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In Ayatul Kursi, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala describes His kursi. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَسِعَ كُرْسِيُّهُ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ. His kursi extends over the heavens and the earth. What is the kursi of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? What is Allah's kursi? Who can tell me? Not the throne. The throne is the arsh. The kursi is? No. The footstool. The kursi of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is His footstool. And here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala describes His footstool as extending over the heavens and the earth. This entire universe, the kursi of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala extends over it. That's only the kursi of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In the hadith of Abu Dharr al-Ghifari radiyallahu an, he said that he asked the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he said, Ya Rasulullah, what is the greatest of that which has been revealed to you? So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam responded and said, Ayatul Kursi. And so Ayatul Kursi is the greatest verse in the Quran. It is the greatest verse in the Quran. Then he said, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said to Abu Dharr, Ya Aba Dharr, the seven heavens, compared to the kursi of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, is nothing but like a ring thrown into a barren desert, and the superiority of the arsh, the throne of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, is like the superiority of the arsh over the kursi, is like the superiority of the desert over that ring that is thrown into that huge and massive desert. And so this is the greatness of Allah's creation. So how about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala Himself? Imagine that a ring that you throw in the middle of a desert is like the kursi of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and this massive desert is like the throne of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, of which the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam informed us that it is the greatest of Allah's creation. What is the greatest thing that Allah has created? It is His throne. The arsh, the throne of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, is the greatest of Allah's creation. Greater than the earth, the sun, this galaxy, this entire universe. You have the footstool, then you have the throne. The throne, the greatest of Allah's creation. And then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, Wallahu fawq al-arsh, and Allah is above the throne. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is above His throne in a manner befitting Himself. This is the greatness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So when one constantly reminds himself of this greatness at all times, whether he's worshipping Allah or whether he's carrying out his daily affairs, this will help him to remain firm and steadfast in the face of all types of fitan. The second means or ways that we can help ourselves to remain firm and steadfast is by remembering the value of the life of this dunya, the value of the life of the dunya. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in different places in the Quran, has given us the example of the dunya compared to the akhirah. And as an example, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, قُلْ مَتَاعُ الدُّنْيَا قَلِيلٌ وَالْآخِرَةُ خَيْرٌ لِمَنِ اتَّقَى. Say to them, O Muhammad, that this dunya is short. The enjoyment of this dunya is short. It is little. As for the akhirah, then it is far better. For who? Not for the one who simply says that he believes, but for the one who has attained taqwa. لِمَنِ اتَّقَى. The one who has attained taqwa, the one who fears Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He is conscious of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And so a person should live in this world as if he is a traveler, as the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam informed us. And a traveler, he takes with him from this dunya what he needs. When one of you travels, he sets out on a journey, he takes with him of luggage what he needs. He does not take everything with him. Similarly, we are travelers in this dunya. We should take what we need and leave what we don't need. And leave what we don't need, because this is a temporary life. It will one day come to an end. As for the akhirah, it is permanent and eternal, lasting forever. Among the means and ways that we can help ourselves to remain firm and steadfast upon this deen is by remembering the stories of the prophets and the messengers of the past and what they went through of fitan, of tests and trials. And this is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said to his prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, وَكُلَّنْ نَقُصُّ عَلَيْكَ مِنْ آيَاتِ وَكُلَّنْ نَقُصُّ عَلَيْكَ مِنْ أَنْبَاءِ الرُّسُلِ مَا نُثَبِّتُ بِهِ فُؤَادَكَ. Here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling his prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that everything that we reveal to you and we narrate to you of the news of the messengers of the past, it is for what purpose? It is so that we may make strong and firm your heart thereby. And so this is the Prophet of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the greatest of mankind. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is relating to him the stories of the prophets and the messengers of the past in order to strengthen his heart so that he remains firm and steadfast in the face of fitan. And this is why the prophets and the messengers, they faced what no other human being after them ever faced, of fitan, of tests and trials. They were forced out of their homes. They were stoned, pelted, mocked, and so on and so forth. And yet they remained firm and steadfast in the face of these fitan. And so when we read these stories, it will help us to remain firm and steadfast, because it will remind us that what we are going through is nothing compared to what the prophets and the messengers of the past went through. And take, for example, Prophet Nuh alayhi salam, who called his people for nearly 1,000 years, and yet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that only a handful accepted his message. And when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala drowned his people and Prophet Nuh and his followers were saved, Prophet Nuh asked Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, what about my son? And so Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said that your son is not from your family because he was a disbeliever. And so his very own son did not believe in him. And he was sorrow and sad because of that. Look at the test and trial of Prophet Yunus alayhi salam, and how he was eaten up by the whale, and yet he remained firm and steadfast. And likewise, all of the prophets and the messengers, their stories have been narrated in the Quran in great detail for this very reason, so that it may help us to remember what the prophets and the messengers of the past went through, and that what they went through was far greater than the tests and the trials that we go through ourselves. Among one of the most important ways and means that we can help ourselves to remain firm and steadfast upon this deen is none other than a du'a. By calling upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala when we are faced with the fitan that we are faced with. And this is why Salama, the wife of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, she mentioned that the one du'a that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to make the most was Ya muqallib al-qulub, thabbit qalbi ala deenik. That, O turner of the hearts, keep my heart firm upon your deen. And so, she asked the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Salama, why is it that this is the dua that you used to make the most? So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Ya Salama, indeed there is no human being except that his heart is between two of the fingers of Ar-Rahman. يُقَلِّبُهَا كَيْفَ يَشَاءُ. He turns these hearts as he wishes. And so each and every single one of us, our guidance lies in the hands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah guides whom He wills, and He allows to go astray, to misguidance whom He wills. And so one should never become self-deceived and think that because he has grown his beard, he is praying five times a day, he is coming to the masjid, he should never think that that's it. Now he's going to Jannah for sure. He should never guarantee himself that, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He guides whom He wills, and He leads astray whom He wills. Sometimes even righteous people, they may slip and fall. And as we mentioned, the story of the Christian who died as a kafir after he had believed in the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He had memorized Surah Al-Baqarah, Surah Ali Imran, two of the greatest surahs of the Quran. He became a companion of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. What greater status can one achieve than that? And yet, he died in a state of kufr, without iman. And so one should always be asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to keep their heart firm upon the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and upon righteousness and upon iman. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to keep us firm and steadfast upon iman and upon this deen. And we ask Him subhanahu wa ta'ala to protect us from every type of fitna, ma zahara minha wa ma batan, what is apparent of that and what is hidden. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to protect our young ones and our youth, especially in this society. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to guide them all to His straight path. Subhanakallahumma wa bihamdik. Ashhadu an la ilaha illa ant. Astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk.